This recording has been edited and modified. This recording is not to be duplicated or sold unless given permission by New Beginning Empowerment Church.
There's quite a bit of reading, and I have to read this in order for you to fully appreciate and understand it. 2 Chronicles chapter 30. And Hezekiah sent to all Israel and Judah and wrote letters also to Ephraim and Manasseh that they should come to the house of the Lord at Jerusalem to keep the Passover unto the Lord God of Israel. For the king had taken counsel in his princes and all of the congregation in Jerusalem to keep the Passover in the second month. For they could not keep it at that time because the priests had not sanctified themselves sufficiently. Neither had the people gathered themselves together to Jerusalem. That's a very important verse. And the thing pleased the king and all the congregation. So they established a decree to make proclamation throughout all Israel from Beersheba even to Dan that they should come to keep the Passover unto the Lord God of Israel at Jerusalem. For they had not done it of a long time in such sort as it was written. So it had become abandoned. So the post went with the letters from the king and his princes throughout all Israel and Judah, and according to the commandment of the king, saying, "Ye children of Israel, turn again unto the Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, and he will return to the remnant of you that are escaped out of the land, of the hand rather, of the kings of Assyria. And be not ye like your fathers, and like your brethren, which trespassed against the Lord God of their fathers, who therefore gave them to desolation, as you see. Now be ye not stiff-necked as your fathers were, but yield yourselves unto the Lord, and enter into his sanctuary, which he has sanctified forever. And serve the Lord your God, that the fierceness of his wrath may turn away from you. For if you turn again unto the Lord, your brethren and your children shall find compassion before them that led them captive, so that they shall come again into this land. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you if you return unto him." So the post passed from city to city through the country to Ephraim and Manasseh, even unto Zebulun. But they laughed them to scorn and mocked them. Nevertheless, divers of Asher and Manasseh and Zebulun humbled themselves. So there were some in those cities and came to Jerusalem. Also in Judah, the hand of God was to give them one heart to do the commandment of the king of the princes by the word of the Lord. And there assembled at Jerusalem much people to keep the feast of unleavened bread in the second month, a very great congregation. And they arose and took away the altars that were in Jerusalem, and all the altars for incense they took away and cast them into the brook Kidron. Then they killed the Passover on the 14th day of the second month, and the priests and the Levites were ashamed and sanctified themselves and brought in the burnt offerings into the house of the Lord. And they stood in their place after their manner, according to the law of Moses, and the man of God, the priest sprinkled the blood which they received at the hand of the Levites. For there were many in the congregation that were not sanctified. Therefore the Levites had the charge of the killing of the Passovers for everyone that was not clean to sanctify them unto the Lord. For a multitude of the people, even many of Ephraim and Manasseh, Issachar, and Zebulun, had not cleansed themselves, yet did they eat the Passover otherwise than it was written. But Hezekiah prayed for them, saying, "The good Lord pardon everyone that prepareth his heart to seek God, the Lord God of his fathers, though he be not cleansed according to the purification of the sanctuary. And the Lord hearkened to Hezekiah and healed the people. And the children of Israel that were present at Jerusalem kept the feast of unleavened bread 7 days with great gladness. And the Levites and priests praised the Lord day by day, singing with loud instruments unto the Lord. And Hezekiah spake comfortably unto all the Levites that taught the good knowledge of the Lord, and they did eat throughout the feast 7 days, offering peace offerings and making confession to the Lord God of their fathers. And the whole assembly took counsel to keep other 7 days, and they kept other 7 days with gladness. For Hezekiah, king of Judah, did give to the congregation 1,000 bullocks and 7,000 sheep. Wow. And the princes gave to the congregation 1,000 bullocks and 10,000 sheep, and a great number of priests sanctified themselves. And all the congregation of Judah with the priests and the Levites, and all the congregation that came out of Israel, and the strangers that came out of the land of Israel and that dwelt in Judah rejoiced. So there was great joy in Jerusalem. For since the time of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, there was not the like in Jerusalem. Then the priests, the Levites, arose and blessed the people. And their voice was heard, and their prayer came up to his holy dwelling place, even unto heaven. Now when all this was finished, all Israel that were present went out to the cities of Judah and break down the images in pieces and cut down the groves and threw down the high places and the altars out of all Judah and Benjamin in Ephraim also in Manasseh until they had utterly destroyed them all. Then all the children of Israel returned, every man to his possession, unto their own cities. And Hezekiah appointed the courses of the priests and the Levites after their courses, every man according to his service. The priests and the Levites for burnt offerings and for peace offerings, to minister and to give thanks and to praise in the gates of the tents of the Lord. He appointed also the king's portion of his substance for the burnt offerings, to witness for the morning and evening burnt offerings and the burnt offerings for the Sabbaths and for the new moons and for the set feasts, as it is written in the law of the Lord. Moreover, he commanded the people that dwelt in Jerusalem to give the portion of the priests and the Levites, that they might be encouraged in the law of the Lord. And as soon as the commandment came abroad, the children of Israel brought in abundance the first fruits of corn, wine, and oil, and honey, and of all the increase of the field, and the tithe of all things brought they in abundantly. And concerning the children of Israel and Judah that dwelt in the cities of Judah, they also brought in the tithe of oxen and sheep, and the tithe of holy things which were consecrated unto the Lord their God, and laid them by heaps. In the third month they began to lay the foundation of the heaps, and finished them in the seventh month, 4 months to lay up all the tithe and offering. And when Hezekiah and the princes came and saw the heaps, they blessed the Lord and his people Israel. Then Hezekiah questioned with the priests and the Levites concerning the heaps. And Azariah, the chief priest of the house of Zadok, answered him and said, since the people began to bring the offerings into the house of the Lord, we have had enough to eat and have left plenty, for the Lord hath blessed his people, and that which is left is this great store. Then Hezekiah commanded to prepare chambers in the house of the Lord, and they prepared them and brought in the offerings and the tithes and the dedicated things faithfully, over which Cananiah the Levite was ruler, and Shammah his brother was the next. Let me share with you this morning when the purging take place. I had to read all of this text in order for you to get the full understanding of what this text really encountered. You had to understand why the chambers were built. You had to understand why the offerings and the tithing and the dedicated gifts came in such abundance. Something had to transpire prior to the people's hearts being willing to release. So I want to direct your attention to the importance of either turning to are returning to the place of repentance that truly delivers your heart and your soul from the wickedness of the world and this world's system of operation. That was a long statement, so I break it down. I want to deal this morning for a few moments with you and your heart. If you have not turned, turn. If you have turned and turned away, return. Back to the place with God, to where true repentance takes place, so that your heart does not contain the things of this world, which constitutes for idols. It's easy. Share this with me aloud. Say, it's very easy. How easy is it? Very easy. It's not hard. It's very easy to have an image that is false, distracting you. Not only distracting you, but causing your attention to be taken off of what God commands for your life, what God desires to see in your life, and placed on the things that will harm your life. Can we all agree on that? Amen? Now, with that noted, sharing with you about what happens when the purging takes place is what I want to deal with today. What happens when the purging takes place? And a purging is simply this. I did not put any notes up on the screen this week. I sent an email to church administrator, and I let him know that I was tossing with this word this week, so to speak, and I come to the end of my time limit or time period to have gotten my information to the media, and I had not gotten it there. So I say, look, we just won't put anything up. If this is what the Lord would say, then we would say so. Amen? So I come to the conclusion that when purging takes place, purging is simply this. It literally means the removal of what is not wanted, what is not needed, what is not necessary, what is not required, or what is not mandated. To purge, let me draw some natural analogies. I promise y'all won't be too long. When there is a need for your body to empty toxic waste, I have to be professional and dignified in my delivery. I sometimes I want to be countrified. I say, when you got a backup. The thing about, and you can identify with this, and this is going to help you to understand the heart condition. When you have an internal backup in your natural body, it disrupts your life in a bad way. Your energy is down. You don't have a passion to do anything. Your desires, things you know you ought to do, you don't do because you have something that's distracting you. And it's not just distracting you, but it's not needed. It's not wanted. It's not even required. You didn't mandate this to be in your body like that. You thought when you ate those meals that it would, your body would naturally go through the process of releasing those foods at the point of time. But for some apparent reason, they got stuck there too long. And what's in you that does not belong in you, it causes complications to your life. Now, using that natural analogy, it same effects happens in our heart. When we have something going on in our hearts that shouldn't be going on in our hearts, it causes a distraction in our lives and a disruption in the order of God. We read where Israel had forsaken for a while what God had commanded to be done every year, the keeping of the Passover. We read where the priests had not prepared themselves, had not sanctified themselves as the law required so that they could be ready for this. We read where even once this came to the attention of the king, and the king says, this is good, we need to get back to basics. Tell your neighbor, you need to get back to some basics. One of the first basics you need to get back to is having a daily relationship with the Lord. I just talked to the internet people this morning. A daily relationship with the Lord. Not a Sunday morning relationship. Not a every now and then Wednesday show up relationship. But a daily relationship with the Lord. Basic principles that the word of truth has already ordained, mandated, and commanded for our lives. So when a purging takes place, it releases what is not needed. It releases what is not wanted. It releases what is not required. It releases what is not mandated. These things are things that go on in our heart. Most of us are doing things in this hour that's not needed. We're doing things that's not mandated. We're doing things that's not required. I use a term constantly in my wisdom dissertations that if it's not necessary, don't do it. Where many of us do unnecessary things because of the status of our heart. Some of you right now are sitting in church and your heart is not in fellowship. Oh, it's quiet in here. The mouse is out again this week. That's the church house mouse when the saints get quiet. Listen, time is too short. If you can't read the signs Jesus gave us in the text, in the gospel, he told Matthew, he shared with him a lot of things about the coming of the end of days. He says, when you see these signs, know that I'm nigh, even at the door. And there are so many signs happening in our society right now, but many Christians are still going through religious motions because of a condition of their hearts. And some, even right now, just like some in the cities of Manasseh when they went through there, and Ephraim when they went through pronouncing the decree of the king, the Bible says some of them in the city, some of Israel laughed to scorn the king's decree. The decree was, let's gather at Jerusalem at this appointed time and take back up the Passover again that's been required of our God. And even in this day and hour, there are some that's laughing to scorn when they hear truth preachers like myself that teach and preach the raw truth. They're laughing to scorn and saying, this is 21st century. We don't do that in church no more. Preachers don't talk like that in church no more. You got to be a little bit more politically correct. No, you don't. You have to be scripturally sound. Paul talked to Timothy about sound doctrine. He says, stand your ground, man, because in the last days, there's going to be a group that rises up, and all they're going to have is itching ears, and they're going to seek out somebody to tell them what they want to hear and not what they need to hear. I've come to tell you what you need to hear in this hour. You need to hear that maybe your heart has become stained with the world's operation, which presents falseness, corruption, and idols. And if that's the case, you need to have a purging again, because after the purging, something takes place. Three things happen in this text real quick, and I'm going to get to some pointers. One was, they got back to what God had told them to do. Two was, in that process, it caused their hearts to become tender. They repented, and after they repented, the second thing is, they pulled down the altars of darkness. See, nothing changes in your life until you have a true repentance and a change of heart. You can come to church every week and not be changed. You can stand at the altar one Sunday morning, shed a few tears, and tell a lie. Until confession and heart align, confession is a lie. I said that again for those that missed it. Until what your lips say and your heart agree to, then your lips have lied. If your heart is not agreeing with your lips, you lied. In other words, a confession of repentance of sins is not genuine unless there is a conviction in the heart that aligns with the speech. You don't confess in sincerity until there's a conviction of your sins. When the word of truth convicts your heart of your sin, then your mouth utters a repentance unto the God of truth and righteousness, that the blood of Jesus shed on Calvary will cleanse you from the unrighteousness that's in your life and will purify you with that blood, and your heart then becomes cleansed in the presence of God. But if your lips are just uttering something that you are emotionally experiencing at the moment, then your heart was not genuinely in it. Many have come to the altar with an emotional repentance and not a convicted heart.
It's easy to get sentimental and emotional when hell is kicking you in the shin bone, so to speak, and putting you in a headlock, and you roll up in the church one Sunday morning, and the word is good to you, and it's just ministering to all your problems, and you get emotional and walk to the altar and shed a few tears and go through a repeated prayer and walk back to the seat, and nothing has really changed because there was no true conviction in your heart. It's also easy, if the conviction was genuine and your salvation is real, to get caught up in the society again, or the world system again, and allow the idols of the world to begin to be reestablished in your life. And many have truly come to the Lord, repented, received salvation, but went back out and did not allow the word to sanctify them daily. Y'all looking at me with that look. See, the word of God, you become, there's what is classified as instant sanctification and progressive sanctification. Instant sanctification is the moment you get saved that God sanctifies your heart, your spirit. Progressive sanctification is the cleansing of your ways in progress and in process. As you see the light, walk ye there. That's word. Come on now, that's scripture text. As you see the light, walk ye therein. That's a process. We are becoming daily sanctified in righteousness, in truth, in our habits, in our life, in our lifestyle, in our conduct. Are you understanding this? But if there's no daily fellowship with the word of truth, if there's no daily fellowship with the truth himself, the spirit of truth, then you are not becoming what God said. Instead, you find yourself regressing to what you confess to come out of. So he has brought us out of darkness into the light, but if you're not careful, you will entertain the things of darkness. It's easy to get caught up with the world's way of doing business. It's easy to allow those on your job that's in authority to convince you that what they tell you to do is what you need to be doing, that opposes truth. It's easy for them to get you to go along to be a team player, because after all, you might be next in line to move up here. The question becomes, do you want to move into corruption? Or do you want to move in righteousness and enter into the corrupt places and change them? I'm challenging you with some good word. Amen. You might want to jot this one down. You will always have an inability to see the true God as long as you hold the image of false gods. You will always have the inabilities to see the true God as long as you hold on to the images of false gods. You will always have the inabilities to see the true God as long as you hold on to the images of the false gods. False God images. And this is one of the problems with Israel. They had began to entertain false God images. The images were literally erected throughout their lands, town squares, hillsides, etc., and temples. And they were literally entertaining the images of false gods, and now they have forsaken the yearly keeping, the annual keeping of the Passover. It's so easy to begin to forsake the things that the 21st century New Testament church ought to be doing when you are entertaining the things that the world is doing. You can get so caught up in you and yours, and what I want, and what they show me, that you lose complete sight of who God really is to you. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. The enemy has power. And he has a magnetism in his power that is very luring and enticing. And most of you think you are where you aren't. And when you think you are where you're not, you deceive yourself and you become vulnerable to the tricks or strategies of darkness. You know that you are developing a strong, unified relationship with the Father. Because if you're not developing that, you're going to become susceptible, subject to entertaining the things or the images that the world says is good for you. You're in a certain position on your job, the world doesn't have a problem with telling you, showing you how to fudge things, how to toe the line, how to make the appearance, which in reality it all will relate to deception, cheating, dishonesty, etc. But they have a way of showing it to you so that it really doesn't appear that way. It's using the loopholes. And many Christians are subject to using, quote unquote, the loopholes, which are filled themselves with holes of immorality. You got to be cautious of how false gods represent themselves to you. You have to be cautious of how idols of this world set themselves up in your presence so that they can become your base of operation. They can become your method of principles or ethics of use in life so that they can become what you are guided by in your daily activity. And when that happens, you turn from what God has already commanded and ordained that you should not only walk in, but that you should have. It's easy for you to show up here on Sunday mornings and not have a heart to do ministry, not have a heart to serve the Lord, not have a heart to give. And you if you ain't careful, you'll find yourself penny pinching and call yourself giving according to Scripture. I've had people to come in here and give. I know what they make. And they have given not even a good tip in a restaurant and called it a tithe. See, there's something going on in the heart when you're thinking like that. There are some idols of this world system that's got your attention when you do things of that nature. So what you don't shout this morning, that's okay. You know, run around the church for your new car. That's all right. You can get that new car. You can get that new husband, that new wife if you're single. You can get that new house on the hill. You can get that $1 million contract for that business. But you got to do some purging. And I'm not here to tickle your bones. I'm here to get your attention. There's some things you got to get out of your way. There's some stuff you got to get out of your eyes, some images that your eyes have been attracted to that you got to get rid of, because as long as you see them, you would never have the true abilities to see the true and living God that you claim and confess to know as Savior, as Lord, as Creator of all. Stuff of this world will blur your vision. So in this modern day, the image of false gods for the majority is not erected in temples. It's not on hills out in our suburbs. It's not in the town squares. But those false gods are erected in the frame of our minds. So many have received the image of sin that has shown them, listen, the image that sin has shown them concerning obedience to the Lord and his word. And that image says these things. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. It says, trust your own wisdom. We'll do a few scripture surfing, and then we'll close out. That image says, trust your own wisdom. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Look at verse 19. Because that tells me something differently. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. Oh, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent.
So that means if the false things that's erected in my mind is telling me to trust my wisdom, and the word says that God's going to destroy the wisdom of the wise, then that means that I am being deceived by the images that are present in my mind. How many times has the enemy told you, and you told yourself, I know what I'm doing. I got this. Watch this now. And those words came outside of a divine consultation. In other words, you had not consulted with the King of Kings. Those images that are erected in the frame of your mind not only tell you to trust your own wisdom, but they tell you to rely on your own judgment. Proverbs chapter 21. What they do, Bishop? They tell you to rely on your own judgment. And look at what Proverbs chapter 21 shares with us. And if you draw your, let me draw your attention to verse number 2. Proverbs 21 and 2. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes. But the Lord pondereth the hearts. So in your own eyes, you're right. How did you draw that conclusion? It's drawn based upon the images in your mind that's controlling your thinking and your actions. So I'm right in what I'm saying. I'm right in what I'm doing, and I have not talked to God about this yet. See, you got to be careful of what false idols would do, because false idols, as I already shared, will distract you. And they'll take away your ability to see the true living God, because they have you focus more on self. That's why you got to watch this doctrine of secular humanism that teaches you about you have the power yourself. I don't have the power myself. I have power given to self by the Creator to do some things. But I don't have any power of myself. See, it's very tricky. It's very tricky, because those words, if you ain't listening and watching carefully, and you're not shocked by the spirit of truth, the way people coin words will make you think that it's okay because it sounds pretty right. You know, the power of the mind. Yes, I have the power of the mind. God's given me a limited control over the mind. But anything that I have, it came by God. So if I'm thinking based upon the world's way of talking about the power of the mind, then I'm literally saying I trust in my own mind myself. And I can't trust in my own mind myself, because my own mind is corrupt from sin. So I have to trust in the power of God and His word for my mind. So when I'm using the power of self, if you will, I'm using that power in the power of God. Yeah, I don't know if y'all getting this or not. Is this registering in anybody other than me? But see, if you're caught up with what the world say and what the world show you, they have a way, Satan has a way of making it sound right, making it sound good, making it sound okay. And for most Christians, believe it or not, are carnal-minded, which means they have not allowed the word of God to renew them in their mind. So therefore, the way they think is based upon how they were before they got saved. So their pattern of thinking is still sinful in nature. So if your pattern of thinking is still sinful in nature, it's easy for you to accept what sounds okay based upon a sinful thinking mind. See how these things creep in? And you can tell the Lord, thank you, hallelujah, love you, Jesus, and yet you have in the frame of your mind erected idols of the world's images that's controlling your daily talk, your daily act, your daily life. And those things you should be paying attention to that God says for you to do, you're not paying attention to it because you're not focused on it, because they're not important to you. I'm teaching good in here. Am I teaching good out there in the internet world? Thank you. So what does the frame of the false gods set up in the frame of your mind say to you? Follow me, Proverbs chapter 3. Here's what they tell you. Trust in your own understanding. How many times have you quoted Proverbs 3 in verse number what? 5. That's the one I want. Proverbs 3 and 5. And Proverbs 3 and 5 says this. Trust in the Lord. But false idols will tell you trust in your own understanding. Proverbs 3 and 5 says trust in the Lord. And watch this now. And do not have confidence in your own understanding. And the original King James says, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In other words, God is cautioning you. Don't you take a whole lot of confidence in your secular flesh. Paul says the flesh is corrupt, and he says in it dwelleth no good thing. That's why when you got saved, your flesh didn't get born again. Your spirit did. Your flesh is still not saved. That's why daily you have to sanctify your habits and your ways and bring flesh under subjection. And the enemy knows this, and so he's targeting the control of false gods and images. He's targeting the flesh. So everything that he's enticing and luring you with, it all attracts the flesh. When you, and I know you probably won't, but if you were ever to study the history of Israel in any depth, you don't have to be deep, you don't have to become a theologian, but you will find out that every time they turned from God in their conduct, it was because they were attracted to what the other nations were doing. That's why they left the daily Passover. They're attracted to what other nations were doing. That's why God gave them their first natural king. Because they were attracted to other nations having a natural king, a human man. And God was trying to convince them, I'm your king. You don't need a human king on a throne. I'm your king. And they said, no. We see them. And them were not walking with God. Them were not God's people. Them were not God's chosen. Y'all looking at me strange. Oh, my God. You are God's chosen. You're not to be looking at them and saying, I want what them got. You should be looking at him and says, I want what he got. But if you are looking at what they got and it has gotten in the frame of your mind, you have the inability to see what he got. And you'll never see what he got until you see who he is. And until you see who he is, you'll never do what he say. That's why we don't bring the tithe and the offerings and the dedicated things into the church today like we ought to. Because we can't see him in his power. We see what the world say. And the world says, hey, you know how it is out here. Times are tight. Tighter than 29. Y'all know how some of the old saints talk. Tighter than Hoover days. You better hold on to it. Got a little something, you better keep it. Don't be taking that church again to them preachers. And some of the saints just go along with that conversation. Yeah, you're right. Then watch this now. Then the devil starts showing you stuff. That ain't got nothing to do with your relationship with God. Look at the car you drive. I bet your preacher got one better than that, ain't he?
Yeah, he is.
Look at where you live. I bet your preacher live in a better house.
Yeah, he do.
Then you're going to take your money to that church. You better put some aside and get you a good car. Images in the mind. And what do? Watch this now. Watch how seriously religious we get. Lord, you know that's right. Lord, you know. No, the Lord said, no, that ain't right. Because your perception now has become completely altered by the false things that's been presented to you. Lord, have mercy. And when you start seeing what is a lie, the devil's biggest weapon he used is not his power to transform himself into an angel of light. His biggest weapon is a lie. But he would never tell you a lie in the form of itself. Oh, my God. Every lie comes camouflaged. Because if he told you the lie in the form of itself, he would be telling you the truth about the lie. So what does he do? He camouflages the lie to make you believe it. And we sit in church week in and week out in America. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. But all week long, we're living in the frame of false gods. We're conducting business based upon lies and false images. Because that which doth appear does not appear in the form in which it appears. But that which doth appear appears in a form that it does not want you to know the truth about. So what do? We lean to our own understanding. We trust our own wisdom. We trust our own judgment. Why? Because after all, we grown and we our own man. We our own woman. Nobody had to tell. Look, I'm grown. Ain't got to tell me. I know what I'm doing. Even at 50 years old, I know what I'm doing. Even at 60, I know what I'm doing. You know, we can understand a transformation and a transitioning of life when you're a jitterbug. You know, we can understand that when you 13, 14 adolescents going through your puberty and all that stuff, we can understand you grown and knowing what you're doing. We understand the frame of mind, the simple thinking of the young folks. But when you up a certain age and you still grown and know what you're doing and life still have not panned out, the enemy is still using you, your stuff is still messed up, something wrong. Still can't see God's promises to your life because all you can see is what's really happening to you negatively. And so now the devil's got you thinking, I got to make everything happen for me. And if I don't do it, then it won't get done. Keep trusting in your own power. Look how far it's gotten you. Has your own power made you rich yet? Has your own power healed your body yet? Has your own power made your relationship with your other insignificant better? I did say that intentionally, insignificant. The little humor, don't nobody get bit out of shape, little humor. What happens when idols are set up in the frame of the mind? You begin to depend on your own knowledge. Anybody noticing a pattern here? Wisdom, judgment, understanding. Look at Proverbs 22:17. What it says about that. In Proverbs 22:17, it says this. Here's God now talking to you through the writer. Bow down thine ear and hear the words of the wise and apply thine heart unto my knowledge. Whoa. Let your heart receive his knowledge. Who knows you better than the one that formed you? But if and when you come to the place you think you know you better than God know you, that's when you begin to make decisions based upon the lies of darkness and the false images that the world has set up in front of you. And that which God has ordained and mandated for your life, not only are you not walking in it, but you're not participating in it. That which is ordained to walk in it, that which is mandated to participate in it, you're not doing either. So then the works of the Lord, church, I got one more and we'll move along. But the works of the Lord then, when you see things your way, when you understand things on your own volition, when you have your own knowledge that you have summed up. Then the things pertaining to the kingdom is neglected. And you never see the necessities for improvement and increase. And many of you have already become comfortable in the routine, the generic, and the basic. I just wonder, on a side note, I only have about 7-8 minutes left. I just wonder, somebody's going, wow, a short message today. Yeah, I got to give you something to go back home and work with. I didn't really come today to tickle you. I came today to challenge you. I came today to provoke you in your thinking. I came today to challenge you in your heart to make sure that you don't show up next week like you showed up today. But Bishop, I came okay today. Good, like I said, to make sure you don't show up next week like you came today. So you came okay today. I don't want you to come back okay next week. I want you to come back next week improved, much better, greater. Are you understanding me? So if we address things that you need to deal with, in the first place that you need to deal with is what happened in the reading of the text. You need to have, the king now has sent out a decree through me. I'm posting it in the sanctuary today. Are you getting the message? We read the text where the king sent out a decree throughout all the different cities, and they posted it. And some in the cities laughed them to scorn. Did not we read it? Where the Bible said there was a remnant of them that took heed and went to Jerusalem. Do I have a remnant in here? Do I have a remnant out there that's going to take heed? Now, I know some are still laughing and scorning and saying, you know, que sera, sera, what it is, it's always been, that's where it's going to be. And others are saying, Lord, you're talking to me because I have gotten a little bit stiff-necked. I've gotten a little bit selfish. I got a little bit complacent. I'm a little bit laid back. I'm a little bit lackadaisical. I'm not as interested as I need to be. I'm not as concerned as I ought to be. My focus is not really on you and your word and your will for my life, but my focus is really on a lot of stuff about world issues. I need to go back home, God, and reexamine myself and have a real repentance even today before I walk out of this place and know that my heart has turned again to obey your commands towards my life. I'm not just going to go through motions, but I'm going to obey your word. It's a bad thing to confess to be a Christian and go through religious motions and not really live a Christian life. Joy comes in serving the Lord with gladness. Joy comes with serving the Lord with gladness. I heard this morning in the right reading of the text, the invocator said, I was glad when David said, I was glad. And I want to run out and say, that's what David said. Ask the people what they say. David said he was glad when they said unto me, let's go in the house of the Lord. But what say ye? We don't act like that. We don't portray that. And there's a reason why we don't act like we're glad to be here. That's the reason why when praise and worship, even to this very morning, is going on, we are standing like we lost in space. That's the reason we got to be told to lift our hands. And after 30 seconds, they go right back down to where they was in the first place. Something is going on in here that ain't lining up with God. And until this gets shown up right, we're going to struggle until all of us die. Trying to get, as the old saying, go trying to get blood from a turnip. Isn't that, you can't get blood from a turnip or something like that? Yeah, you can't. I can never pull out of you what's not genuine. I can't make you love God. And every church in America, I don't care whether you're black, white, Hispanic, Asian, whether you're mega church, got 10 members, 10,000 members, 100 members, I don't care, large, small, medium, it doesn't matter. Every church has the majority of people standing in there that don't genuinely love God. I'm convinced of that now. If your church is differently, hey, that's great. Praise God. You a rare breed. But I have literally been across almost half of this country and out of this country many times. And I've not seen most churches, most people go through motions. And you see the motions because their hearts are not genuine. See, if your heart is genuine and you know it, you just automatically pick up everybody else's spirit that ain't. I was talking to a young man this week, sitting in my house, and I said to the young man, I says, you know, a sinner can walk into any church and within a few minutes pick up the genuine believers in there and the fakers. And they don't have the gift of discerning the spirits because they're not born again. They just operate in what God has given all of us, the abilities to see naturally. So when these things are erected in your mind, last one, you let your own will be done. Go to Isaiah 66. You let your own will be done. Wow. I need you to hear what God said here. In Isaiah 66, verse 1. Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. Where is your house? Now, where is the house that you built unto me? And where is the place of my rest? Oh, my God. What are y'all building around here for the Lord? For all those things have my hand made. And all those things have been, said the Lord. But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembleth at my words. So what is God looking for? The man that's not boastful, proud, arrogant, stiff-necked, pompous, but a man that is of, that term poor means of a humility, of a humble, not ain't got nothing to eat, not homeless. Poor, he's talking about poor in humility, that's humble. He says, I'm looking for a man that has a contrite heart, a heart that is yielded to me, a heart of passion, a heart of compassion, a heart that is open. A man that awes at my words. A man that reverenced me, trembleth at my words, oh mighty God. Not a man talking about, yeah, what? Are you getting the picture? Look at verse 3. He that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man. He's talking about how we deal in life. And he that sacrificed a lamb as if he cut off a dog's neck. He that offered an oblation as if he offered swine's blood. He that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Yea, they have chosen their own ways. You see this here? Going through motions without a heart yielded to God. And their soul delighteth in their own abominations. Take pleasure in our religious actions. And God is giving you some analogies here, examples of how your religious actions are reflective towards him. He says, this is how I see it. Oh, you offered up a lamb, but this is how I see it, as you cut off a dog's neck. Oh, my God. Are y'all all right? I also will choose their delusions and bring their fears upon them. Because when I call, none did answer. When I spake, they did not hear, but they did evil before my eyes and chose that in which I delighted not. Hear the word of the Lord, ye that tremble at his word, your brethren that hated you, that cast you out of my name, out for my name's sake, said, let the Lord be glorified, but he shall appear to your joy, and they shall be ashamed. They did their own will. That's the point. And this is God's insight to that. This is how God says, I see this. And this is what's going to happen. Those last two verses, he said, verse 4 and 5, he says, I'm permitting things now to begin to happen based upon your actions. Did you see this? I will choose their delusion. Delusions will come. You will be deceived based upon your own actions. I'm not going to block because your will is being done. Remember, God made us as moral free agents. In other words, he gave us the privilege to do what we will. That's why he didn't stop Adam from sinning, even though he knew he would, because he created him to do his will. If God had created him to control him, then he would have created slaves. But he didn't create slaves, he created children. That's why even you as a parent, even when your child begins to rebel, you let them go. You don't build a cage and lock them in and say, you're going to stay in this cage under this key and chain and lock until you learn how to do better. No, you don't do that. You let them go. It's their will. You already know they're heading for trouble. That boy heading for trouble, he's going to either be dead or in jail. Lord, it grieves my heart. But I cannot control his will. God will not control your will. So your will being done that opposes his will for you creates trouble in your life. Now, the extremes of these areas I just mentioned of life, they vary. But the operation of all of them are the same. And this is why in most all churches, there are confessed believers that do not tithe faithfully, do not give offerings faithfully, and that they hardly ever commit to dedicate a special offering unto the work of the Lord. Now, thank God it's not as bad in this church. Whew. Thank God it's not as bad in... thank God it's not as bad in this church. But I still have those that are not faithful to service, not faithful to offerings, not faithful to tithing, not giving to dedicated things. We want to dedicate a building to the work of the Lord. They don't bring a dedicated offering, a.k.a. building fund. Because the devil's already told them that $30 a week tithing they give and that $10 a week offering they give, that's enough. So they never, ouch, I know. So they never with passion, with a desire, they never seek out the face of God for witty inventions and directions and instructions and ordering of steps into venues that they can gain access to revenues that can aid and assist in the, y'all just going home. Why? Because their heart's not there. Why? Because it needs a purging. See, the house of the Lord is not in your mind. What happened after they repented, met back at Jerusalem, kept the ordinance of God, repented, kept the Passover? What happened next? The next thing they did was dismantle what was erected that opposed God. You don't dismantle nothing until you come back to the altar. Your heart has to turn again to God. Then you go back and examine your life and how you go about your daily activities. And you say, this got to go. This been here too long. That's got to go. That's blocking my path. That's standing between me and God. That's in a way. That's taking over the priorities of my time. I got to get rid of this here. I got to start spending money over here like that. I got to start getting this done. You start now getting things together. What happened after they tore down the altars? We read it. Go in the 31st chapter. The third thing that happened was they heard the cry of the priest and the king. And they began to bring tithe. We read three things. That's why I went all the way down to verse 12 in the 31st chapter. Because they didn't just bring the tithe and the offering. But the Bible goes on to say they brought the dedicated things. The dedicated things is what is needed for the temple work. If I say we need a new camera, that's a dedicated thing. See, that's where the extra money come in at, other than the tithe and the offering. But the Bible goes on to say the people's giving was so abundant. from the third month to the seventh month. From the third month to the 4 months, they were in placing it in piles. Okay, I know we're not going to bring that much money in here. Don't misunderstand me. They were bringing in animals and corn and, you know, and wine and all that stuff. You know, they were bringing barrels of this. And you know, you bring in 100,000 sheep, it's going to take you a while to sort them out and, you know, skin them up and do what you got to do and get them in place and salt them down or whatever you're going to do to preserve them. You see what I'm saying? It takes a while. But then the scripture says they had to build chambers in order to secure what the people had bought. It'd be so nice if we were able for the bank to borrow money from us. Y'all missed that one. Shoo. Wouldn't it be nice if the church was the entity that the bank says, look, we want to borrow $100 million of y'all's money and invest it. That'll never happen until you can see it that way. Because nothing about your life would ever become corrected so God can pour into you that way until you start seeing how God really sees the life of the church, the life of the believer. And as long as you got some stuff that the world has set up in your eyes still hindering you, you'll never see him for who he really is. For he's a good, good father. That's who he is. For he's a good, good father. That's who he is. Did you hear what I just said? And if he's a good, good father, then he has made us to be great in his sight. While you're standing on your feet, I want you to begin to examine your heart. Because we got to exit out of some things. And until we take time out and return to some basic principles of the Word of God, till there's a genuine concern for his house, then the things that we see are going to continue to get worse and nothing will get better in the Lord's house. But I'm telling you right now, when you purge the impure thoughts that Satan has erected in your mind, you're going to bring to the Lord that which blesses his holy name. You're going to bring to the Lord that which blesses his work. And you're going to bring to the Lord that which reveals a true harvest to all the world around you. And the Lord then will be magnified. We got to return to the good, good God. One of my right now favorite songs is getting ready to be played. And for the past 48 hours, literally, I've been waking up with this song in my spirit. I've been going to sleep with this song. This song, turn it up a little bit for me. This song has just been by Chris Tomley. I want you to listen to it. Come on and pump it up for me back there if you don't mind. Come on up a little bit more. Yes.
Never alone.
Yes.
You're a good, good father.
Is that all the bottom you got? Come on, there you go.
It's who you are.
Yes.
It's who you are.
Yes.
I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
I'm loved by him. That's who I am.
It's who I am. It's who I am.
See, you got to see God for who he is. Listen to the words.
Many searching for answers.
See, many searching for answers.
Far and wide.
Answers far and wide. They search far and wide for answers.
We're all searching for answers.
That been you?
Only you provide.
Searching for answers that only he can provide.
Uh-huh.
He's a good, good father. Who you are, Lord. Yes. Yes. who I am. Do you know who you are? You are loved by God. That's who you are. He's perfect in all his ways. He's perfect in all his ways. Yes. God does not make mistakes. You are. Yes. Yes, you are, Lord. You're perfect in all your ways. Yes. Think about what the singer is saying. You are perfect, Lord, in all your ways. Cannot, as I said earlier, make you love the Lord. You got to love him for yourself. But until you really fall in love with him and see him for who he is, excellent, perfect, in all his ways, he loves me so much. I can't even explain him. The songwriter says his thinking is all messed up. I can't explain you just all that. See, until you see God like that, you can't see what he'll do for you. There's nothing you are handling right now. There's nothing you are facing right now. There's nothing that surprises God, that amazes God. There's nothing right now that's beneath him or over him. He's a good, good father. That's who he is. He's a good, good father. And as the songwriter said, I'm amazed by him. And right now, I don't know what you have allowed to get between you and your true relationship that just have you at the moment going through life, existing. Going through motions of Christianity, but not really operating as a real Christian. You're not witnessing to anyone. You're not spewing out the love of God upon others. But you're just going through daily life trying to make it. That is not the will of the Father. And it does not please the heart of God. If you allow God to purge your way of thinking, to empty out all of the negative that you have allowed to come in over the years of your life. Regardless of how it got there or how much of it is there, that's irrelevant. What's truly relevant right now is, God, there's some things going on in my mind that shouldn't be going on. There's some activity happening in my life that shouldn't be happening. And I need you right now to purge me, to empty me out of all of that, and to give me a clean slate. God, help me in my thinking. God, help me in my daily routines. Father, I ask you to order my steps. Direct my path. Let all of my ways be pleasing unto you. God, it's not about me no more. I've been too busy ripping and running and trying to get my career moving and doing this, that, and the other. And God, I realize I'm acting just like the world around here. They running crazy and stopping by Starbucks every day and grabbing their 24-ounce cup of caffeine trying to make it through the day, and I'm just like them. I got an evil spirit in the morning until I get my cup of coffee, and then I'm okay. God, something wrong with this picture. That's not who you made me to be. God, I'm not taking care of my house like I should. I'm not even taking care of my body like I should. And your word said that my body is the temple of your Holy Spirit, Lord. I'm not eating properly. I don't rest well. God, help me. Somebody right now need to repent. Say, God, help me. Help me not to be like this here. I have drafted the ways of the world, Lord. And if I'm doing everything they doing concerning my daily activities, obviously, God, I think like them. Obviously, the rest of my life is thinking like theirs. Obviously, I'm thinking towards my finances like they do, towards my health like they do. Lord, help me. He's a good, good Father. That's who he is, perfect in all his ways. And he loves you. His love for you is amazing. That's who you are. You're not a piece of dog meat to be cast aside, cast to and fro, thrown around. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. And God has a design plan for your life that's beyond anything you have attracted yet. Those of you watching by way of internet, maybe you heard everything I shared. You see, you said, Bishop, my God, you were just all in my life today. Well, that's great. Praise God. That's why you tune in. That's why we're meeting at this time. God had preordained it before the foundation of the world. But now that's said and done. Are you going to change? Are things going to get better? Are you going to increase? Are you going to increase in your love? Are you going to increase in your relationship? Are you going to increase in your prayer? Are you going to increase in your praise, in your worship, in your giving? Are you going to prioritize your time now for the Lord? That's what's important. What will he truly say when this life is over and you see him face to face? Will his words be well done? Or will his words be woe unto you? What will he truly be able to say? That's what I want you leaving here today really thinking about. How have you been thinking? How have you been acting? What have you been doing? Versus what does God want from you? Because until your true love for him increases, our time together has been wasted. I have not wasted mine. I said our time together has been wasted. Let your love increase. Let your love intensify. You fell in love with that woman. You fell in love with that man. You fell in love with that job. You fell in love with that car. You fell in love with that house. Fall in love with the Lord. Let your falling now be in a righteous way. And I'm telling you right now, saints, when you love him, it ain't a struggle. It ain't a struggle. It ain't a struggle to praise. It ain't a struggle to show up on time for church. It ain't a struggle to do ministry work. It ain't a struggle to give. It ain't a struggle. It's a joy, a pleasure. Because you have confidence in knowing that God the Father loves me. That's who I am. And he's awesome in all his ways. That's who he is. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the word today. I thank you for blessing your people to hear the truth. I thank you for giving them grace today that is sufficient. Lord, I ask you now to make manifest this message
into the very core of the hearts of every receiver, that not one word fall by the wayside, but that hearts are open to receive and they're filled with this truth, with this plea, with this warning in the name of Jesus. We're sounding the alarm on the hillside. I pray that your people hear it and answer the call. Thank you so much for grace today. Amazing grace, special grace, divine grace, powerful. We love you because you did first love us. And we give you thanksgiving right now for what we shall see based upon what has already been done. And this is our prayer today in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and we believe to see it. And those in agreement said amen. Thank you so much for tuning in out there today. I believe that the word has always has been an encounter in your heart. And I want you to click right on the screen right now and go straight to Givelify or put something in mail today. But whether you do it by electronics or by snail mail, be a blessing to the work of the Lord. We will appreciate and we will honor and cherish every seed sown, because we believe that it's going to be sown in love, it's going to be sown in faith, it's going to be sown in compassion for the work of the ministry. Thank you so much. We look forward to being right back here with you. And I want you to have a fired up week. If you're watching right now still yet and you have not gotten us your email address, just go to info@newbeginac.com and send us your email address. And every Monday morning, like clockwork, or every Monday evening, like clockwork, you're going to get a power aid just from me, specially to help you through your week. It's free, and it'll bless your spirit. So send us your email address, and we're going to send you weekly power aids that's going to cause you to be excited about who God is. Till we meet again, be ready. Get back in front of that computer screen again on Wednesday evening at School for Ruling. And we'll see you back here the next time. Get that seed in the mail right now. God bless you. We love you. And we'll see you at the next service. Zonites, say hallelujah. To God be the glory. Amen. We come to the conclusion of another wonderful, powerful Sunday morning celebration. Amen. As always, I'm still desirous of you that you would begin to invite someone, encourage someone to be a part of your fellowship setting. Your church grows by you. Your bishop is doing everything that's professionally possible, business-minded possible, and literally possible on his behalf to grow our fellowship. It's up to you to spread the good news of your church. It's up to you to share the love of Jesus Christ and to get someone else drawn to that love and excited about your ministry works. So the more enthusiasm you show Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, the more people you'll see show up on Sunday morning. And until we get an impact on Sunday morning, we won't have an increase on Wednesdays. Hallelujah. So make sure that when you walk out the door this evening, you walk out excited about the empowerment zone and the fact that God is ministering to your spirit in the empowerment zone and your life is being transformed by that word and you're having a healthy fellowship relationship with the believers in Christ. Amen? We're not about schisms and isms and mess up in here. We're not about sister so-and-so talking about sister so-and-so and brother so-and-so and so want to fight brother so-and-so because he's talking to his wife outside the church and all that crazy mess. We ain't about that stuff up in this house. Amen? Ain't no schisms and isms in here. So it's a healthy fellowship. Amen. So tell somebody. And stop just coming. I'm glad you come, but I want to see somebody standing beside you, behind you, in front of you, that came with you, that showed up because you've been out and about the Father's business. Amen. So fill up the house. Let's go into 2016 with a zone filled. Souls out there, and they need what you're getting. And you know it. You probably know three people right off the cuff of your sleeve, as they say, that need what you're getting. It's just going to be a matter of you really taking some personal time with them and becoming more personal. There are a lot of people that needs one-on-one attention. And so the old adage is, everyone make one.
Thank you for your purchase. We know that it has impacted your life in a great way. If you would like to purchase more dynamic messages, call us at 757-722-6791 or join us on the web at www.newbeginningec.com.